Welcome to Revolutions Weekly, where we dive into the details of unwinning periodic revolutions, elections. I'm your host Alvin, and today we're going to be talking extensively about the 2020 Burmese election. So if you kind of checked social media, if you kind of checked news networks within the last few weeks, you'd kind of know that there's been lots of protests going on in Myanmar at the moment. You know, things like with all the police crackdown, all of the suppression and things like that, and the widespread protests all across the country. So then of course you might be asking, you know, it's like, what exactly is the cause of all of these protests? And I think it's like, you might know it has something to do with the recent military coup as well, and you might also know that, oh, you know, this might also have something to do with the election that was happening last year. So as a prelude to the events that are happening right now, I'd like to dive in a bit more into this particular election. And it kind of like speaks volumes, and it's just very an interesting topic overall to talk about in terms of just like, you know, Myanmar's long journey to democracy, and as well as trends that, you know, you see with newly democratic countries in the region and even globally. So if you're a casual observer of Burmese politics, you would roughly know that Myanmar's recent democracy has always been this battle between the NLD, which is the National League for Democracy, led by Aung San Suu Kyi, as well as the military, in this case represented by both the USDP, so the Union Solidarity and Development Party, which is like the military's political party essentially, led by former military officials, as well as the military themselves, through representations in parliament. So I think currently the way Burmese parliament works is that 25% of the seats are actually allocated to the military itself. So you have both a pro-military party, and then you also have the military themselves in the parliament. So all the things that's kind of like happened in 2020 essentially, you know, happened first in 2015. I mean, just in general, Burmese democracy, especially in its current form, is a relatively new phenomenon, as I alluded to earlier. So I said there was an election in 2015. So this 2020 election essentially is only the third quote-unquote democratic election that has happened in the country since 1962, when the democratic government back then was couped out of power, basically. So the first election was, of course, the 1990 election. So this 1990 election, just quickly, so this happened right after, as a result of the 8888 uprising. So it happened on the 8th of August, 1988. So essentially in this particular uprising, the BSPP, which is the Burma Socialist Program Party, which had been ruling the country up at that point for, 26 years as a one-party state, was essentially overthrown. So prior to this, there were elections, but there was only one party, so it wasn't exactly a free and fair election, and there wasn't exactly a lot of choices to begin with. So this party got overthrown, and as a result, in 1990, they decided to have this particular election. So in this election, the NLD won, so Aung San Suu Kyi actually won that election. But the military immediately annulled the results, basically calling it fraudulent, calling it fake. And then after that, well, Aung San Suu Kyi was basically put on house arrest, and that kind of like snuffed out any hope for democracy at the time. So from 1990, you know, it's like when the new government would have been formed after the 8888 uprising. Now, the country is instead ruled by a military junta, basically direct rule by the military. Same thing that's happening in Thailand right now. So that was the case up to 2010, when they decided to call another election. Now, in this election, interestingly enough, I think it's like, it was also like another hope again where we could finally get democracy in Myanmar. But I think it's like after some like things, suspicious things that was happening, ultimately many political parties, the NLD most prominently, essentially boycotted this election. So because the NLD and many other parties boycotted this election, essentially it was only the USDP standing in as like the sole main party. And of course, as a result, they were able to form the government in this particular election. So that was the case from 2010 to 2015. I mean, technically, 2010 election did happen and it did form the government. But, there was definitely a lot of suspicion in regards to like how it was set up. So now then we get to the 2015 election, which in which the NLD actually first got power. So I think prior to this, the USDP was actually the party that was gaining, that had all the seats in parliament, almost all the seats in parliament. But in 2015, all this immediately shifted where the USDP was basically kicked out of power in favor of the NLD and lost essentially almost all their seats. So now the NLD got basically the majority of the seats. I think actually they actually got a bit more than two-thirds of the seats, which essentially enabled them to, have that two-thirds majority in parliament and essentially be able to push most of the bills that they would like to in parliament, but it wasn't enough ultimately to push for big constitutional changes, changes which ultimately would be needed to push Myanmar towards being a full-fledged democracy. Basically, all of the provisions in the current constitution, which grants the military extensive powers. So, in the Burmese system, you would need 75% of parliament to agree to a constitutional amendment. But because the military and the USDP have just enough seats to make the NLD fall short of 75% of the votes, they weren't able to push ultimately for these really big changes that are really needed. But even with all those hurdles, nevertheless, there was no doubt that Myanmar was basically becoming a full-fledged democracy. Of course, it's not perfect because of the things like the military seat allocations and stuff like that, but it was definitely, it's definitely moving in the right direction. I could say that for sure. So now we get to the election itself. So what exactly changed in 2020 from 2015? Well, basically nothing much, honestly. So overall, what basically happened was the NLD, of course, won a thumping victory again, and they won basically three more seats, and the USDP basically lost four seats. So this is both in the House of Nationalities and the House of Representatives. So in case you don't know, Myanmar basically has a bicameral system with a lower and upper house, with the House of Representatives being the lower house and the House of Nationalities being the upper house. But nevertheless, what this victory does show is that the trend that we saw in 2015, where the population overall seems to support this idea of democracy, this idea of increasing freedoms and things like that, this is a very popular idea. So in 2020, with the big NLD win, it basically validates this idea once again, to the ire of both the USDP and the military. And of course, this victory nationally is also backed up by lots of victories in the states as well. So in the case of the NLD, they were able to basically form a government in most of the states. The USDP, I think, was able to form one state government, but I think overall the NLD was basically dominant in all the elections that they contested in. Now, up to this point, you might be wondering, I've only mentioned two political parties, the NLD and the USDP. So where are all the other political parties? Well, to tell you the truth, I think when Myanmar, with just how new the democracy is, the NLD basically holds a monopoly of the democracy vote. Essentially, to all those people who favor anything but the status quo, the NLD is the party that they vote for. Whereas the USDP, of course, is the opposite. They're the pro-status quo party. So anybody who likes military rule would vote USDP. So basically, in the new democracy that we have in this case, yeah, so you won't, you're not going to see a lot of variation in terms of prominent political players, but you are seeing a diversification. So for example, in the Shan state and in the Rakhine state, you do have like strong regional parties, but outside of that, they all most of the other ones only have like one seat, two seats. So the NLD and USDP are the most prominent players in this case. But anyways, so as it stands right now, we have another NLD victory, another USDP and military defeat, basically. So everything was basically, to most people, going pretty well. And the fact that they actually had their second fair election, shows good things are definitely gonna happen going forward. Of course, this was the thought back then. And then we have the military coup. So this coup, as you all may know, happened on the 1st of February. So interestingly enough, their parliament was actually meant to be confirmed on the 2nd of February. So this coup was, of course, basically meant to prevent that from happening. So this coup was, of course, spearheaded by the head of military, Min Aung Hlaing. And basically, his main reason for conducting this coup was basically accusations that the election was illegitimate, the election was fraudulent, and as such, until new elections are able to be held, the military will once again take over control of the country. So there's a lot of speculation as to why this coup actually happened. The most prominent, of course, being that the military fears that it's losing its grip on power, and that the NLD is just going to be more and more popular day by day, and eventually the USDP will be completely kicked out, and the NLD would have that coveted 75% of seats that they need to actually start making changes in the constitution, and as such, in the end, maybe also kick the military out of parliament itself. So, of course, you could say that this is the case, but, and there is definitely precedent for it, but I don't really find this case particularly appealing, or at the very least, I don't think that this is the only cause, because while, it is certainly the case that the military is losing power, but like I said earlier, nothing really changed. The status quo remains the same. They're not able to push through these big constitutional amendments. So at least in the foreseeable future, things are likely to remain the same. But now there's this other theory which says that this is purely a personal ambition issue. So where General Hlaing basically wanted to grab power for himself. Now, we know we can't exactly verify this, but it is interesting nevertheless to think that, because it didn't happen with the last guy who was in charge. So, maybe perhaps we could see him playing a bigger role in Burmese politics in the future. But as of right now, it's honestly still very hazy as to what exactly is the reason of the coup. Besides, of course, the official reason, but there's definitely something going on behind the scenes. So, right after this coup basically happened, as most of you may know, people immediately started protesting in the streets. So, they were banging pots and pans, they were going out literally just in the street protesting, and mind you, this is during COVID, right? So they're definitely risking their health and safety as well for this particular movement. But it's not like the military themselves have not used COVID as an excuse to suppress the population further. And prior to the election, that was the case. Now there is a legitimate movement nationwide. So now the suppression has only all but intensified. And the fact that Aung San Suu Kyi and many of the NLD activists, many of the NLD leadership are currently under house arrest, it also doesn't bode well for Burmese democracy going forward. But like I said, these things are still developing, so we'll just have to see what happens going forward. Now, to many observers outside of the region, particularly and especially Western observers, such events, such phenomenon may seem pretty absurd, pretty alien, in that, it's pretty much unimaginable that governments could like literally just be toppled in this way by the military. But this trend of military coups is actually relatively common in Southeast Asia. So I think, like I said earlier, for example, most recent example being Thailand. Now, Thailand, and we'll probably talk about this in a future episode, Thailand has actually an interesting history with military coups. To date, they have about 7 different coups, so as such, about 7 different constitutions. And of course, Indonesia, where the situation from the 70s to the 90s basically mirrored the situation that we have in Myanmar right now, where, you have a military dominance in the state, the military forms part of the parliament, things like that. But I think what makes the Burmese case ultimately interesting is that I think until recently, Myanmar has really been a secluded country. It's been closed off to the rest of the world. Not as bad as North Korea, but they've definitely been relatively closed off, isolated. So as such, seeing them finally open up for business, seeing them finally open up, politically as well, it has certainly been an interesting sight to many in the region and to many globally, because it's one of the last countries in Southeast Asia to actually do so. Cambodia and even communist Vietnam and Laos opened up way back in the 90s. So Myanmar is definitely a holdout in this regard. And it'll certainly be interesting to see what happens with the nation's democracy, with the nation's economy, and all these things going forward. So now we go back to reality. So what exactly can the NLD do? Now, this is the part of the show where typically I'll maybe talk about electoral strategy, but this is a very interesting case in that, well, there's not really much of a strategy in that, you know, you can't really campaign because everything is kind of suppressed and against you systematically. I think certainly it would be interesting to see where this big movement goes forward, because I really do think that with the big pressure, with the immense pressure that the people are putting on the military right now, they would likely have to concede on something. Now, ideally, it would be the resumption of democratic government and, you know, like, allowing Aung San Suu Kyi and the NLD to retake their places in government, or, you know, even call new elections as soon as possible. But either way, at this point, I really can't say. And of course, a quick word of caution, just because they say they will call elections doesn't mean they're going to do so anytime soon. Thailand, you know, being a good example where after the coup in 2014, it took them 5 years to finally call an election, which I think ultimately was kind of a farce because many military people and many people backed by the military were actually standing in the election, and with some meddling and gerrymandering and things like that, they were able to basically retain power. But anyways, if in other places where people have not had a taste of democracy, of more freedoms, could actually overthrow their rulers. Now that Myanmar have had about 6 years of experience with open democracy, I think it'll be pretty difficult for the government to actually make the case to take those rights back. So I do believe that the movement would achieve something. We just don't know what. And of course, you know, electorally, if they do call elections soon, well, then the NLD would probably get a victory again. And probably now, likely even a bigger victory because of just how brazen the military has been in suppressing the population and the protesters, which ultimately doesn't bode well for the current arrangement that they have right now. So in the next 3 weeks, I'd like to try something interesting. So next month, there'll be multiple state elections all across India. Now, you're gonna learn really fast in this series that I actually love Indian politics. So for the next 3 weeks, I'd like to look at three different states, basically go through with you their electoral history, all of the prominent political players for this upcoming election, big electoral issues, if there are any significant ones, past trends, maybe even future trends, and I think just what these results would mean for, you know, national trends in Indian politics. So the three states I'll be looking at for this 3 week series is gonna be Kerala, Tamil Nadu, and West Bengal. In no particular order, due to my personal interest in the politics of these states and as well their fascinating political history. And if we have time, we might also even cover Assam and Pondicherry. But anyways, that's it for me right now. See you next week.